saints abide just over in the glory land. And I long to be by my Savior's side just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land I'll join the happy angel band. Just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. There with the mighty host I'll stand. Over in the glory land. I am on my way to those mansions fair. Over in the glory land. There to sing God's praise and His glory share. Just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land I'll join the happy angel band. Just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. There with the mighty host I'll stand. Over in the glory land. What a joyful thought that my Lord I'll see. Over in the glory land. And when kindred say there forever be. Just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land I'll join the happy angel band. Just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. There with the mighty host I'll stand. Just over in the glory land. With the blood washed throne I will shout and sing. Over in the glory land. Glad Hosanna to Christ the Lord and King. Just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. I'll join the happy angel band. Just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. There with the mighty host I'll stand. Just over in the glory land.
374. 374. My, what a difference a week makes. And I want to say, our deacon board, canceling church is a difficult call to make, but I do think they made the right decision. But they're as slow as tortoises. That was a four-hour thing getting that decided back and forth. Are we going to do it or not? And I came down here, and Kenny Hall Enterprises had cleared the parking lot. Thank you, Kenny. But if you drove some of these county roads last Friday or Saturday, you're a better soul than I am. It was a little slick, Johnny. I tell you, I prayed through three times just to get down here. Anyway, let's sing page 374, Jesus is Coming Soon.
Trouble sometimes are here, Billy men's hearts with fear. Freedom we all hold dear, now is at stake. Humble your heart to God, saves from the chastening rod. Sing the way pilgrims trot, Christians awake. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night. Going where no one dies, heavenward bound.
146. Just a moment after we have some spoken prayer requests and then some updates. Jason DeGree still needs our prayers. Mike Wilkes, Sister Clara Dodson, Pastor Ken Dodson is home after surgery. Don says he's doing well, and I'm sure they would appreciate a card if you could get one in the mail to them. Doris is having surgery this week. That's why she's not here. She is having her aorta valve replaced. She's had this surgery 10 years ago, but the warranty's up on the thing, and they got to replace it. So big surgery for her, and she's kind of anxious about that, so keep her in mind. We're delighted and thankful that God has allowed Lee and Darlene to be with us this morning. Darlene had a minor surgery on her nose this week, and Brother Lee has still been having some issues, but we're delighted they're here this morning. With your permission, I'm going to take this yellow mic down there, and rather than me talk about them, Lee, I'm going to ask you to give us an update on how you're doing and what's coming down the road. Please.
Well, I don't know how I'm doing. That's the thing. I've got more doctor's appointments coming up this week. Had an MRI one day last week. The days run together when you go back and forth to the doctor all the time. But I had an MRI. I'll get a doctor's report when I go back Thursday. I've got an appointment tomorrow with my cardiologist in Springfield. And I hope one of them or both of them will tell me something. They tend to examine me and say, come back another time and we'll see you later, you know. But I'm doing better. Thanks for your prayers. I'm just not getting my strength back like I have before. Darlene works me too hard at the house, and I think that's the reason. Appreciate you. Covet your prayers. God bless you all.
Thank you. And I know we'll all be continuing to remember Lee and Darlene in our prayers. If you'll do that, let me hear a roof raising amen.
Amen.
Amen. A special note. Lee brought this in this morning and gave me just a moment to read this very special note from Brother Josh Provo, a missionary to Bulgaria. He's been in our services here before and has presented. I'll just read this. It says, "Good morning, 10 days into the war in Ukraine. And just so you know, Bulgaria is very near that Ukraine area where all this fighting is taking place. 10 days into the war in Ukraine, somewhere around 1.5 million people have fled that country. Since the vast majority of the country's 40 million people are women, children, or elderly, the flood of refugees may just be beginning. While nations that directly border Ukraine are facing the brunt of this flood, many are coming to Bulgaria as well." And then in highlighted it says, "I don't know how many have come here, but I'm confident it is already in the thousands, if not the tens of thousands. As of right now, there are more than 100 Ukrainian refugees in our city, the vast majority living in government housing. It's expected that in the coming days and weeks, the government will open up whole buildings of old dorm rooms, potentially making a place for many hundreds of these refugees. I'm trying to imagine what it would be like for me and the kids to flee our homeland and seek refuge in a strange land. Most have little more than the clothes on their backs. And because the ATMs and banks stopped working, many do not have access to their savings accounts, etc. Because so many normally take, people are fleeing and crossing the borders are limited. A drive that would normally take 12 to 13 hours now takes in excess of 2 days. They're arriving exhausted, hungry, and in need of a shower and clean laundry. Beyond all that, they are anxiously thinking about their husbands and sons who have stayed behind to defend their homes and livelihood. As families and as a church, we're looking for creative ways to be the hands and feet of Jesus during this extreme crisis. Here are just a few of the ways. People from the church have participated generously in a campaign to collect food and supplies for the families who are coming to us by the busload. We have offered our services as translators and are hoping to begin free Bulgarian and English classes for future refugees. In coordination with the city government, we have opened up our church to a family of five, two sisters along with their three kids. One sister has two 17-year-old boys. The other sister has a 10-year-old daughter. They're living in a spacious apartment in the upstairs of the church we renovated years ago in anticipation of it becoming a parsonage. Tim and Lydia waited at the church until midnight so they could welcome this family. Yesterday, Naomi made them cookies, and with Autry's, we went to the church for lunch and spent time with them. They were so grateful when we told them they could stay at the church as long as they needed. I think they understand that the vast majority of the millions of people fleeing Ukraine are not so fortunate. We're praying that God will open up more doors for us. The daughter will most likely be enrolled in Phoebe's class. They are so excited. Because the local government is unequipped to handle all of this on their own, our church will be taking on all living expenses for this family. We're also anticipating many other opportunities to provide food and supplies as more people arrive. If you feel God's leading you to take part in this ministry, Hannah Project has created a special fund so people can easily donate to our church's relief efforts. You can give online, and we have a website for that. My promise to you is that we will strive to meet not only the physical needs, but also to share the hope of the gospel. God bless. And again, this is from Brother Josh Provo. That, along with our spoken prayer request, I want us to go to the Lord in a word of prayer at this time and ask God's blessing upon this ministry. As we've read here, I can only imagine should something like that, God forbid, ever happen here in our great United States of America. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer and ask His blessing upon these needs and the other spoken prayer requests. Jared Wormington, would you stand and word our prayer, please? 54.
There will be a happy meeting in heaven, I know, when we see the many loved ones we've known here below, gathered on the blessed hill. Glad day, all wonderful day, glad.
Take a moment. I'm going to ask the musicians to play through that chorus one more time. Take a moment and greet some neighbors and just tell them it's good to see them and you're looking forward to that glad reunion day, all right?
Good morning, everyone. Am I on back there?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, good. Couldn't hear myself. As long as you can hear me, that's good. I don't know about you, but just simply listening to the report in, well, it just feels like the world's just falling apart, doesn't it? Just kind of feels like, you know, just, ugh. And then listening to that report, I was reminded that, you know, when the world falls apart, God does not. Aren't you happy for that? I mean, even though the refugees and the struggles that's happening over there, isn't it amazing that there's a small group of people who are asking what they can do to glorify God? I'm so grateful to hear that because we know that that's happening. I've read quite a lot that we know that there are Christians who are standing for their faith and making a difference in what's going on. And I'm encouraged by that because I'm grateful that though the world seems to be spinning out of control, God is not. And he's still on the throne. Aren't you grateful for that this morning? I truly am also. Has anyone ever heard of Fat Tuesday? Interesting way to start a sermon, isn't it? You know, Fat Tuesday is a term that came years later, but it was based off of this idea before the season of Lent. So Fat Tuesday was this idea of before you make a real commitment to God, go out and do everything you shouldn't do the day before, which is a mess. That should never happen. But you know, over the years, I have studied church history. I have studied some of the church calendar. There were many things that I wish I had known when I was younger about those things because they can be very meaningful. Sometimes we as Baptists, as what we call Congregationalists, in the past we have been so opposed to Catholicism and to those things, and I'm not saying we shouldn't be. But we have missed out on some things because I think we push so far away from something. There is some church history that goes all the way back to the third, to the fourth century for sure, maybe the third century, about the season of Lent. It has been in history for many years. The Catholic Church kind of took it and messed it up. And then they came up with Fat Tuesday, which is always, yeah, that's great. But has anyone this week seen anyone, maybe on TV or someplace else, that they saw someone with a dark spot on their head? I saw that on TV. I saw someone that had that. Those are ashes. The Catholic Church on Ash Wednesday, they started this tradition a while back. And I want to talk a little bit about that, not from their perspective, but from the perspective of what I think God is teaching us and can teach us. A tradition started many years ago that on Palm Sunday, that of course people would bring in palms to the church. And then after that, the church would burn those palms, and then the next year they would use those ashes from those burnt palms to be the ashes that would go on the foreheads of the believers. Ash Wednesday is the beginning of the season of Lent. Years ago in churches, the main thing that they did was read scripture. I'm going to read a lot of scripture today. I'm not just going to do that, but I am going to read quite a bit. Because this has really been meaningful to me in the past, and it's been something that I have not been able to get off my mind. But you see, the season of Lent is basically 40 days before Easter. In church history, beginning, I think, in the third century, the church put together a time frame of 40 days before Easter to prepare people who had been saved the years before. They would spend 40 days teaching them, preparing them, so that they could be baptized on Easter. Isn't that an awesome idea? Isn't that an awesome idea of baptizing people on Easter? Now think about what baptism is. Baptism is the picture of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, right? So that was something that the historical church did. They took those 40 days, and as soon as you're thinking in your mind, some of you are thinking, now if it's 40 days from that Wednesday, that's not 40 days. They took out Sundays because Sunday was already a day of celebration for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So if you count from Ash Wednesday, which was this last Wednesday, until the Wednesday before, and then count to Sunday without using the Sundays, it's 40 days exactly, which that's probably more than you wanted to know. But the ideas of Lent have something interesting. There's some themes that in church history they begin to take because they saw a need of the church to refocus. The themes are reconciliation and cleansing, repentance and confession, and a resolve and a commitment. You see, in times past, when someone gave their life to Christ, they had to go through some things sometimes because they wanted to make sure that these people were resolved to be committed to Christ. That it wasn't just something that kind of an emotional thing, that there was more to that. That it was a true commitment to Christ. So we're going to talk about those themes, reconciliation and cleansing, repentance, confession, and a resolve and a commitment, and of course leading up to the time of Easter. 40 days is significant in Jewish history. Do you guys remember that? Remember hearing something about 40 days? I'm going to read a few passages about that. In Genesis chapter 7, verse 12, rain fell upon the earth for 40 days and 40 nights. What's that referring to? Right. In Exodus chapter 24, verse 18, Moses entered the midst of the cloud as he went up to the mountain. Moses is on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. He was there communing with God. Numbers chapter 14, according to the number of days which you spied out the land, 40 days, for every day you shall bear your guilt a year, even 40 years, and you shall know my opposition. Of course, the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. In Matthew, we find out that Christ went into the desert, and it says after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights. And we also see in Acts chapter 1, verse 3, to these he presented himself alive, referring to Christ, after his suffering by many convincing proof, appearing to them over a period of 40 days, the Christ who was risen. So the day of 40 has some significance in that. And so the early church decided that that 40 days would be significant leading up to the celebration of the resurrection. I remember as a kid thinking about Easter. And you want to know what I thought about it? I've got to get that goose egg. I've got to get that goose egg this year. Because the goose egg was the big one. It was painted gold, and that was the important one. Because back then, no plastic eggs. Tons of kids got sick because somebody had boiled their eggs two or three days before and left them out because not everybody refrigerated everything back then. So somebody was sick barfing in the end after they'd eaten way too many of those eggs. But I was focused on the goose egg because it was bigger. And, you know, there are times that we do things like that, and all of those can be fun and meaningful. But we must never forget the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You see, in this world that is spinning out of control, we can put a fine point and stop it by saying, this Christ is risen today, he is alive today, and he is on the throne today. Now, ashes are also an important part of Scripture. I do want to read some passages about this. Please try to just follow along with me. I'm going to get to a point in the end, maybe. We'll see. Ashes were used as a symbol of repentance and sorrow in Scripture. In Esther, do you remember that there had been a decree out to destroy the Jews? Mordecai in Esther 4:1. When Mordecai learned all that had been done, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth and ashes, and went out to the midst of the city, wailed loudly and bitterly. Job, everyone's heard the story of Job, lost everything, lost his children. He lost everything that he had. And Job 2:8, he took a piece of pottery to scrape himself while he was sitting among the ashes. I want to read a passage from Jonah because this gives us the idea of a focus of ashes. You know the story of Jonah? God told Jonah to go. Jonah said no. Big fish, big whale. God said go. Jonah said yes. Okay? That was a real big synopsis of so far of Jonah. This is Jonah 3:4. Then Jonah began to go through the city one day's walk, and he cried out and said, "Yet 40 days and Nineveh will be overthrown." Then the people of Nineveh believed in God. They called a fast and put on sackcloth from the greatest to the least of them. When the word reached the king of Nineveh, he arose from his throne, laid aside his robe from him, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat on the ashes. And he issued a proclamation, and it said, "In Nineveh, by the decree of the king and the nobles, do not let man, beast, herd, or flock taste a thing. Do not let them eat or drink water. But both man and beast must be covered with sackcloth, and let him call on God earnestly, that each may turn from his wicked way and from the violence which is in his hands. Who knows? God may turn and relent and withdraw his burning anger so that we shall not perish." When God saw their deeds, that they turned from their wicked way, then God relented concerning the calamity which he had declared he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. You see, there's a proclamation of the holiness of God. There's a proclamation of you are at odds with the holiness of God, and unless you repent in 40 days, you will be destroyed. The nation as a whole and the king as a whole got in sackcloth, we'd call it the potato sack, the old potato sack kind of thing, and sat in ashes to show to God, we are repenting of what we have done. The ashes were used as an idea of bringing out reconciliation to God. They were also used as purification. Numbers chapter 19, "And the Lord spoke unto Moses and unto Aaron, saying, This is the ordinance of the law that which the Lord hath commanded, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, that they bring thee a red heifer without spot, where is no blemish, and upon which never came yoke. And ye shall give her up unto Eleazar the priest, that he may bring her forth without the camp. And one shall slay her before his face. And Eleazar the priest shall take on her blood with his finger and sprinkle her blood directly before the tabernacle of the congregation 7 times. And one shall burn the heifer in his sight, her skin and her flesh, her blood, her dung, and she shall burn. And the priest shall take cedar wood and hyssop and scarlet and cast it in the midst of the burning of the heifer. And a man that is clean shall gather up the ashes of the heifer and lay them up without the camp in a clean place. And that shall be kept for the congregation of the children of Israel for a water of separation. It is a purification of sin." Now again, keep following me with these ideas. It is the idea of reconciliation, that God is holy, I am not, and my acknowledgement of that. It is also purification, the idea that because of that, I know that I need to be purified. That was the symbol of the ashes, and we find that throughout Scripture repeatedly. Also remember the hyssop. Remember the hyssop? The hyssop was used to dip into the blood before the angel of death or before the death came through in Exodus. When they took the hyssop and they dipped it into the blood from that little lamb that had been living in the house for those days. And then they took it and they took that blood and put it on the doorposts. It was shown that God is in this place. You see, the themes of Lent, while we sometimes are a little bit afraid to be connected with him, and I've never put ashes on my head, though I always pay attention. I've never experienced Fat Tuesday. I thought about it. You know, let's just eat like a, let's just have at this thing, you know, and then we'll just repent. Although unfortunately, there's sometimes we do live like that. I'll repent later for it. No, you all would never be like me in that, right? Okay. Let's talk again about reconciliation. Lent was supposed to be a time of repentance and confession, sorrow for sin. Easter is a celebration of a risen Savior, but we still need reconciliation and cleansing today. If you want to, turn with me in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. This is a familiar passage. You'll be able to follow me with this, and I'm going to refer back to it in just a moment. 2 Corinthians, excuse me, chapter 5, verse 17. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespass unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead be ye reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Now chapter 6. We then as workers together with him beseech you also that ye receive not the grace of God in vain. For he saith, I have received thee in a time accepted, and the day of salvation I have succored thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. I believe in the world that we live in today, there is a great need of reconciliation and confessing and repentance and cleansing throughout the world. And one of my fears is, one of my thoughts is, and I'm not talking about Macedonia, but I'm including Macedonia in this big picture. I'm wondering within the body of Christ, the true body of Christ. Let me say it that way, because there's some folks today who say they are that, but they just ain't. Okay? I'm kind of there with all of that anymore. I don't agree with everything John MacArthur says, but he does say this. He goes, you know, I'm at the point in my life where I just wish I knew who was with me and who wasn't. And I'm like, I get that. You know what I mean? I kind of get that. But in the body of Christ, the true church, we can never get to a point of where we think we don't need reconciliation, that we don't need confession, that we don't need cleansing, and that we don't need to be closer in a commitment to God. We can never get to that place and to that point of where we look at ourselves in the mirror and we go, I'm all right. Remember the old saying, I'm okay, you're okay, I'm not okay, it's okay to not be okay, none of us are okay. Okay, that just went by you. Without the mercy of God, we are not okay. You and I can never be good enough in the sight of God to say, I'm okay. I was counseling with a husband and wife once. The husband was slimy. he had cheated on his wife who was 7 months pregnant. And so I'm in there talking with him, and first thing is first, I have to get over my anger because I'm ticked off. I'm mad. Because he walks in with this arrogance, and I'm like, I'm going to punch him in the face for her. And we're going to use the Bible. But then we begin discussing, and in the end, I asked to speak to him, and I asked him a question he wasn't ready for. How are things between you and God? He goes, what do you mean? I said, well, I'm not much of a counselor, okay? I was just like, dude, you just told me you've been cheating on your wife. Are you okay with God? Oh, yeah, I'm okay. I don't know what my face looked like, but I would have loved to have a picture. And then it hit me. I needed to ask this question. But is God okay with you? See, isn't that the question? Isn't that the question? That's the question. I'm all right with God. Well, who wouldn't be all right with God? He's amazing. He's awesome. He created us. He did all this. He still supplies our needs. He cares for us. He sent his son to die for us. He's done everything for us. We should be okay with God. But the question needs to be flipped. Is God okay with me? Whole different thought process, isn't it? You see, that's the idea that the early church came up with when they were talking about Lent. It is this concept of making sure that in the sight of God, I am where I need to be. Because Easter is so important. When I get to Easter, I want to be able to celebrate it. And truly celebrate what God has done in my life. We also know, I want to read a passage out of 1 John chapter 1. But if we walk in light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That has become a very powerful verse to me because it's a promise from God. If I ask to be right with God with heartfelt confession and repentance, then I can be made right with God. If I confess, he will make me right with him. If I do this in that manner, so that verse has truly become to mean so much to me. Confession. Can you imagine going and sitting in a little box that's dark and there's some dude on the other side in a box that's dark and you just start shouting out everything you've done? Not going to do it. I've talked to many people, had a lot of friends who were in that faith. And I asked them once, do you really tell them everything you've done? He goes, no, nobody does. And I'm like, well, then what's the purpose? I don't even know. But you see, confession is this idea before the Almighty God, who already knows what we have done, that we are admitting what we have done. Isn't that what we wanted from our kids? Did you do that? No. We knew they did. We wanted them to do what? Admit. Now, you did you? No. No, didn't do that. Not at all. Mm-mm. I'm like, who did that? I don't know. Well, I don't know does not exist. He's not a person. You see, God wants us to acknowledge our sin. Now, listen to Daniel. In Daniel chapter 9, there is this amazing picture of repentance from a guy who didn't need to repent. I'll read and I'll go back and try to explain that. Daniel chapter 9. Daniel is thinking about his people, the nation of Israel. Remember, Daniel's been in captivity at this point. The nation is in captivity at this point. And we know that Daniel is living a godly life. We know that when the king has said, you got to bow before me or this is going to happen, Daniel said, ain't going to do it. They throw him in the lion's den, of course. That's the commitment and the life that Daniel lived. But I want you to listen to this. This is Daniel chapter 9, verse 3. And I set my face unto the Lord God to seek by prayer and supplications with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. Well, this guy is living, according to what we understand, right. I mean, he is working hard to be right with God. But he starts off and saying, I need to fast in sackcloth and ashes, verse 4, Daniel 9. And I prayed unto the Lord my God and made my confession and said, O Lord, the great and dreadful God, keeping the covenant and mercy to them that love him and to them that keep his commandments, we have sinned and have committed iniquity and have done wickedly and have rebelled, even by departing from thy precepts and from thy judgments. Neither have we hearkened unto thy servants the prophets, which spake in thy name to our kings, our princes, and our fathers, and to all the people of the land. Neither have we obeyed the voice of the Lord our God to walk in his laws, which he set before us by his servants the prophets. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, hearken and do. Defer not for thine own sake. O my God, for thy city and thy people are called by thy name. This is an amazing piece of passage to me. Because Daniel is trying to live right, trying to do the right thing. He wants to be right with God. And then he looks at the people around him, and he sees that the people who are supposed to be the people of God are not living the right way. And instead of saying, God, I know you see them like I see them. They need some help. God, this is what needs to happen over here. You need to do this to fix them. They need to repent. They need to do that. This amazing man quite does the opposite. He starts fasting. And he uses this terminology, we. We. This is Daniel 9, verse 3 through 19. We have not, we have. Lord, forgive us. It's this amazing picture of confession and repentance, because this man who, from everything we understand, is right with God, wants to make sure he is right with God, and he includes himself with others who I, if I looked at them, I probably would go, boy, Lord, I'm glad I ain't like those people. But instead, Daniel, we need repentance. We need confession. The psalmist wrote in Psalm 32, I acknowledged my sin unto thee, and mine iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. He that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. Confession, repentance. The last couple of things is I want to discuss commitment and a resolve. That's part of this idea of Lent. I'm not saying we should take this up, although Fat Tuesday occasionally sounds good. But Hebrews chapter 9, if you want to turn me, this is an important passage, Hebrews 9. Hebrews 9 verse 11. But Christ, being come, an high priest of good things to come, by greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of an heifer, sprinkling the unclean, sanctifying the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God? And then there is this commandment, purge your conscience from the dead works to serve the living God. Wow, I'll get back to that. A commitment. Well, Christ called us to a commitment. We all know that. The commitment was this, take up your cross, deny yourself, follow me. That's the commitment that he wants from us. Reconciliation and cleansing, repentance, confession, resolve and commitment. Those three statements, they're kind of a beginning and the end of each of those statements. Reconciliation happens when cleansing happens. Repentance happens when confession happens. Resolve happens when I'm committed. Okay, you kind of see where I went with that. Reconciliation and cleansing. What a time for us to discuss reconciliation. Getting close to Easter time. Be ye reconciled to God. But see, this is also for us as brothers and sisters in Christ. Be ye reconciled to each other. Be ye reconciled in the body of Christ. Be ye reconciled in your homes. Be reconciled in your extended homes. Be reconciled to the people of God. You see, this is a time where the church reflected and it looked at itself. Is there something in my life that's keeping me from God? Because I have something in my life that's keeping me from a brother or a sister in Christ that I need to fix. It's the idea of reconciliation. Be reconciled. What an amazing time to consider reconciliation for husbands and wives. For parents and children, for brothers, for sisters, for moms and dads, to consider what would it be that whatever this is that stands here between us, that we are going to be reconciled so people will see Christ in that reconciliation. In Sunday school, Michael was talking about someone who was so something or other, people knew he was with God. Well, he was successful in this, he was successful in that, but the outside people looked at him and knew God was with him. They could just tell. If we stand at odds always with each other, what do you think the world views us as brothers and sisters in Christ? I'm not picking on anybody. It's just, you know, be reconciled, whatever it is. Cleansing. I've never thought about getting in sackcloth and ashes, but I've felt kind of that bad before. If you ever want to talk about confession, read Psalm 51. It's David owning up to what he did with Bathsheba when he killed her husband. It is just an outpouring of, I am lower than a bug, and seeking God. Repentance and confession. The idea of Daniel just still amazes me. This guy who was going to be thrown in the lion's den for his commitment stood before God and said, we have sinned. We have done this. It's an amazing picture of love. Don't forget that. I ain't including people in my repentance if I don't love them. That's a whole other sermon. We'll not go there, but think about that for just a moment. And confession, resolve and commitment. I think this is why God put this on my mind really quite some time ago. Resolve and commitment. When's the last time in my life I resolved to be righteous? Oh, we could have left without that one, huh? I mean, think on that for just a moment. When's the last time I resolved to live a righteous life? When's the last time I resolved to be committed to follow Christ, to take up his cross, and to deny myself? You see, the idea of denying self is simply this. Tell yourself no. I don't like hearing other people no. I don't like me telling my own no to myself. Think about that, telling ourselves no. Now, I am not asking that we go back to some calendar and we start preaching and teaching off of some calendar of the historical church. But sometimes there are things that we can learn from those who came before us, and they had some pretty good ideas on occasion. A time of focus, a time of reconciliation, a time of repentance, a time of confession, a time of resolve, and a time of commitment, seeking the very face of God himself. Now, I'm not going to put ashes on my head. Looks weird. Some guy walking around. I saw a guy on TV, national TV, had a big spot on his forehead. And I'm like, is somebody going to ask him about that? Or does everybody know? Nobody said a word about it. Oftentimes, it used to be made in the picture of a cross. Now, it's just a thumbprint. But maybe I wonder what the world would look at us like if we walked around in sackcloth and ashes, and when they asked, we said, we have failed to be committed to God, and we're asking for his forgiveness. You all be weird. I'd be weird. You see, because that kind of outward commitment is just, my goodness. But I fear in our world that is spinning literally out of control. Maybe it's a time of repentance and confession. Maybe it's a time of resolve. No matter what, I will stand with God. I am resolved to live a righteous life. I am resolved that when God looks at me, he will say, he's okay with me. Not just me being okay with him, but he's okay with me. He's okay with us. You see, the season of Lent, it's been taken, made weird by people. But back in the 3rd and 4th centuries, the early church used it as a time to refocus their hearts and their minds to the risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Can there be anything better than a recommitment to serve the one true living God who sent his own son to die on the cross for our sins so that we could be forgiven, so that we can be reconciled, so that we can have repentance, so that we can have right relationship with God the Father who created us. I think that's the perfect place to put our focus on, especially during the world spinning out of control. Would you have a word of prayer with me? Heavenly Father, I ask and pray right now that you touch us and that, Father, you help us. Father, when I say we, I'm not pointing at anyone or at anything other than including myself. But Father, we seek you today. We ask for your forgiveness. Father, we ask for help. May we be reconciled, Father, to you in the way that we need to be. But Father, in our relationships here, may we be reconciled. Father, may we see who we truly are in your sight. Not our sight, not our thoughts towards you, but your sight and your thoughts towards us. Father, during this time, I pray that you teach us what it means to have resolve and commitment to you. Resolve and commitment to you. For it is the name of Christ I pray. I'm going to ask them if they would come sing a verse of invitation. In the early church, during that 40 days, they would give up things. Some would give up meat. Some would give up this or that or the other thing. And the reason they did that wasn't so other people would know what they were doing. They would do that because they wanted to show God their resolve and their commitment. Now, there's some things I could give up, I guess. I don't know, but I'm not sure it's about giving up things. I am sure at this, that it is us saying, I want to know what God is saying. And I want him in my life and him to live through me, that I'm going to resolve to serve him. I'm going to be reconciled and confess, and I'm going to be made righteous in his eyes. So I'm not exactly sure how to end the sermon other than to say this. If God is speaking about anything at all in your life, whatever it might be, don't worry about what somebody else is thinking. So what? But if God is speaking today, and he wants you to come and pray for whatever reason that might be, this is an opportunity to do so. Stand with me if you would, please. Sometimes the words in songs, we just kind of sing them because we've sang them so many times. But every time that chorus is sang, I think of that million and one. Isn't that something? Well, I'm grateful I've been one. I'm grateful that I've been saved by Christ because there's nothing good in me whatsoever. But by his goodness and his grace and his mercy, am I a child of God. And this morning, I'm going to ask him to sing just one more verse. And again, if God is speaking, it has nothing to do with me, but if the Holy Spirit is speaking to you, don't thwart that. Let God speak.
as part of the body of Christ at large. Be more resolved and more committed than we ever have been to seek His face in His way in our path every day. If you need Christ, nothing better than knowing that when I die, I shall yet live again. And that's because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. May He bless you and be with you. May our resolve be strong. God bless you. Have a good week, everyone.